So good morning, everyone. So today we'll continue with the rotation motion, and today's topic would be translation and rotation. And you keep in mind also the way written here, translation is separate, rotation is separate. And that's how we deal with combination of translation plus rotation. So let's understand, suppose you have a kind of, it could be a disc, anything round shape. And round shape, actually there are four things which can have this kind of shape. It could be solid sphere, it could be spherical shell, cylinder, disc, or even a hollow sphere. But if it is translating, so what does translation of any object mean? It can be of any shape. If translation, our understanding of translation is angular velocity zero, which means if I draw any line on the object, I find the orientation of the line is not changing. That's translation. And in case of translation, if a particular point on the object has velocity v, every particle in the object will have same velocity. So translation, all particle have same velocity and acceleration. If this is a, every particle in the object also will have same acceleration. So this is what happens in case of translation. This particle also vcm, this part also, every particle has same vcm. But when we come to rotation, similar to motion property here, if it has angular velocity omega, in this particular case, it is given as an anti-clockwise sense. So if a particle is object is rotating about center of mass, you have to assume there's an axis passing through and there's a kind of a hinge here and it's rotating with angular velocity omega. And when it is rotating about angular velocity omega, every particle on the object will have same angular velocity. If this moves by angle some theta, this also moves with some theta. And if it's this important property of pure rotation, every particle same value omega. And at any instance, if omega is known for any particle, this particle, what would be the velocity here? It will have instantaneous velocity r into omega. And which direction the instantaneous velocity will be? Perpendicular to radial vector into omega. That will be v value of this particle. What will be velocity of this particle here? This velocity, it is going with omega. So if this distance is small r, its velocity will be r into omega perpendicular direction. So if object is having pure rotation about center of mass, if I take center of mass and axis, and every particle will have instantaneous velocity, which will be omega multiplied by its distance from the axis of rotation. The farther the point is, faster it will be moving. The speed will be proportional to distance from axis. So all particles have same angular velocity. And in both cases, here it is simple. We can, every particle, we'll know what the velocity and acceleration is. Here also every particle at the instantaneous velocity and acceleration, all points can be formed. So if I call this point as P, what, and if it is a distance is R, it will have velocity equal to R omega, perpendicular to this R vector here. And what will be acceleration it will have? Acceleration will have centripetal acceleration. Centripetal acceleration is r omega square directed towards center. If I have this point Q at a distance smaller from the center, its instantaneous velocity will be r omega, and its instantaneous acceleration will be r omega square directed towards center. So that's what this is very easy point to understand. And unless this is understood, we cannot proceed further. And if this is understood, rest all becomes a lot easier. Okay, so if we have to take kinetic energy of this object here, this kinetic energy, every particle 1/2 mv². And what is the kinetic energy if any object is rotating like this? Pure rotation kinetic energy is 1/2 i(ω²). Since I'm taking pure rotation about center of mass, I'll write as ic(ω²). And I can, whenever I talk about moment of inertia, we can always write this in terms of mk². I is equal to mk², k being the radius of gyration. I'll come to radius of gyration again. Okay, now what happens if it has both kind of motion? In this case, I have drawn two separate cases, VCM separate, omega separate. Now the same object has a VCM, is something like, just imagine, this is object is something like wheel of a car. So it is having, if you look at the axle of the car is moving the velocity VCM, and a wheel also rotating. So wheel is rotating with angular velocity omega about center of mass. If both are there, how do we deal with this? Also, we deal it. We can break the motion into two parts. I will not use perhaps resolved, or it can be broken into two parts. We'll deal with linear motion, translation separately, and rotation separately. So translation, we'll take a translation of, and we can also say this motion can be broken into two parts. One way of saying is pure translation of center mass and pure rotation about center of mass, both taken separately. And if you take both separately, it becomes very easy to understand. And another way of saying is we take motion of mass separately and motion with respect to center of mass. With respect to center mass, it can only have rotation motion. So now, if both the things are there, how do I find, previous case it was okay, if I had to find velocity of this point here, how would I find velocity of any point on the object? I'll find velocity due to translation separately and due to rotation separately. So let's look at this. It will vector sum of the two. So since it is having translation, every particle due to translation, this particle also will have velocity in the same direction as velocity of center mass. So due to translation, this also will have VCM. And due to rotation, it is rotating now in clockwise sense, it will have a velocity perpendicular to its radial vector, and it will have velocity equal to r omega. Which direction? R omega will be in this direction. So this vector sum of the two will give the resultant velocity at this point. Now coming to this point here, what will be velocity here? Translation parallel to this velocity and same magnitude. So its velocity of this point will first calculate due to translation, which would be equal to VCM. Then we think of rotation, which variation it is rotating, rotating the clockwise sense will be perpendicular to this rotation. This will be equal to R omega. So it will be R omega, R being the distance here. So it will be vector sum of this velocity and this velocity. So if we know how to calculate vector sum, so two parts, what we have done, whenever we come across translation, rotation, translation by one point of, we take translation and rotation separately. In case of translation, and then what is the combined velocity? Velocity of a point due to translation and velocity of the point due to rotation. Take the sum of the two, vector sum, that's the resultant velocity. A similar way we can find out resultant acceleration also. Okay, so this is something what we have done. We have broken into two parts. This is translation and this is rotation. So I find velocity due to translation, due to rotation, take the sum of the two. Thus resultant velocity and similar way resultant acceleration. Two parts, translation separate, rotation separate. Instant velocity, any point we choose, we can find out what is the velocity and acceleration. Suppose I take this particular point here. If I take this particular point, what will be the velocity of this point? Okay, due to translation, parallel to the velocity of center mass, same magnitude, VCM. And this VCM. And due to rotation, it is rotating in the clockwise sense. So I join to the axis of rotation, and due to rotation, it will be perpendicular to this direction. It will be R into omega. So if I take the sum of the two, and sum of the two will be something like this. At this particular instance, this particle is not having, because of rotation, because of translation also, it is not velocity like this. It will appear to be moving in this direction. That's how we find velocity, and similar way acceleration. Let's apply this to concept of rolling, because the main syllabus is typically it says only rolling, and we have seen questions which are much more complicated than rolling. Let's understand what does rolling mean. When we take, say, any object which is of its boundary is in form of a circular shape, so it could be a sphere, a spherical shell, disc, cylinder, any of those things. So when it is rolling, let's take example of a sphere. So whenever it rolls on a plane surface, if a sphere is rolling, it will have at any point of time, one point on the sphere only will be in contact with one point on the surface. There are two points which are in contact. And if it will have only point contact. So this particle, red particle is on the sphere and this green particle is on the surface. And when you say rolling, these two particles which are in contact, if there's no slipping taking place, it means relative velocity is zero. Then only slipping does not take place. So we can say a condition for rolling, relative velocity zero, or two points in contact will have same velocity. So basically, what does rolling mean? First, I can start like this. If rolling, relative velocity of two points in contact is equal to zero. So it means velocity of point P on the particle on the sphere has to be equal to velocity of the surface, which also implies velocity of the particle P on the sphere which is in contact has to be equal to zero if surface is at rest. So most cases we deal with, it is rolling on a surface which is at rest. If the surface is at rest, that's the case when the car moves on the road. When the car moves on the road, and you can see here, and you can see sometimes you can see clear tread mark if the car tire is wet and surface is like a cemented road. You can see the tread mark of the car tire. It means when the car is moving, the part of the tire which comes in contact with the road surface here, that's not slipping. So that part of this road is at rest, that part of the tire, if you click a picture also, this point will be at momentary rest. So point which is in contact will come to a momentary rest. That's a condition. So better understanding is relative velocity is zero. So both points which are in contact have same velocity. If this is zero, other also is zero. That's a ruling, very simple way. So at this particular point, since it is VCM and R, let's understand what will happen if it is VCM and R. It will have velocity due to motion of central mass. It will have VCM in the same direction in which the center of mass is moving, VCM. And due to rotation, the distance is R, it will have a backward direction velocity, R omega. Okay. And this sum of these two has to be equal to zero, or VCM has to be R omega. I'm assuming omega to be in clockwise sense. It has to be clockwise sense, then only it will happen. So this is a condition here. And if surface is at rest, VCM minus R omega is equal, no slipping will take place. Condition for loading, two point in contact will have same velocity. If bottom of wire, so this is another way we can understand here. See, all whenever, even in case of rod, see if you take, imagine a rod. We are taken in case of rod also, if it, okay, sorry, leave that rod part. Okay, so let's understand this part. So this is something, see what, if this surface is at rest, what is the velocity of this point? Velocity, this is point is instantaneous rest. This is at instantaneous rest. And rest, no other point is on the sphere is at rest. Only one point is at rest. And that happens only with the axis of rotation. Okay, every point will have velocity proportional to distance from the axis. And any point is at rest means its distance from axis zero, or that point itself is axis. So we can also call it the point which is in contact as instantaneous axis of rotation. And that particular instance, the whole sphere is equivalent to rotating about this particular axis. If it is rotating about this point axis, any point, in that case, it is pure rotation. I don't have to bother about combination of rotation and translation. Every single particle will tend to be rotating about this point. So velocity of this point will be like this. Velocity of this point will be, if I take a radial vector from axis of rotation, like this. So different points on the rolling object will appear to be rotating about instantaneous axis of rotation, and instantaneous axis rotation, about instantaneous axis of rotation, it has pure rotation. There's no translation because this point is at rest. So that is something also we can keep in mind, and though it is not necessary, this also is a good to understand point. Okay, for rolling a surface at rest, if I have to calculate kinetic energy, see, in the case of kinetic energy also, we calculate kinetic energy due to translation and rotation separately and add it up. But if it is having pure rotation, I can take, if point P is the point in contact here, kinetic energy can be taken as rotational kinetic energy, 1 by 2 I into omega square, which I will take, this is the axis of rotation, will take moment of inertia about an axis passing through the point of contact and perpendicular to the plane. So that's how we can calculate kinetic energy only in case of rolling. But otherwise, how do we calculate kinetic energy? Yes.
Sir, will the omega value be same even in this case, like about the point?
I told you omega, any two points also mentioned. Don't ask me again. What did I mention last time? Omega, any two point which is, if this point be on the object, any two points, if object is saying omega. Yesterday I also mentioned this one. I didn't follow.
Huh? Yes, yes.
Yes, all points omega will be same. Omega, any two points we choose is same. And there's a specific reason also why it is same. Okay, now coming to we can find velocity. Now coming to energy here. So when any object is having rolling motion, so it means center of mass is having translation and it is having rotation about the center of mass. So even kinetic energy also we can calculate in two parts, due to translation and due to rotation. And due to rolling, the actual energy is sum of these two energies. and it can be proven also. So we are not going to prove. So what is the condition for pure rolling? This is the condition for pure rolling. So what is the ratio of translatory kinetic energy and rotational kinetic energy in pure rolling motion? See, ratio of kinetic energy, what is 1 by 2 m v square? But 1 by 2 m v square, what is v here? V is equal to r omega. So this becomes my translation kinetic energy, 1 by 2 m v square, vcm square. And this becomes my rotational kinetic energy. What is rotational kinetic energy? 1 by 2 I omega square. What is I here? Mk square. K value will depend on nature of object here, which I will deal now. So this is a ratio. And if it is no, if it is pure rolling, these two values are equal. And ratio becomes R square by A square. That's the ratio of translatory kinetic energy and rotational kinetic energy. And what is the K here? K is called radius of gyration. Radius of gyration is the distance where entire mass should be placed so that moment of inertia remains unchanged. Let's understand a little bit. So what does K mean here? If mass is distributed at relatively larger distance, and so basically if the distance, if it is distributed larger distance, K value become more. So K value depends, gives an indication as how the mass is distributed about axis of rotation or whichever axis K is being calculated about. High K means mass is distributed farther away. Small K is mass is distributed nearer to the object. Let's try and understand in this case here. See, if we take for a ring and this is axis of rotation, ring moment of inertia is mr square. And if I equate, I get a radius of gyration k is equal to r. And why I'm getting k is equal to r? Because entire mass is at the farthest point, which is at distance r. No mass is at a distance less than r. That's why radius of gyration also comes equal to r. So if I have to place for a ring, if there's a ring here, entire mass I can place and at a distance r on the, and this mass also will give him same moment of inertia over center as the ring. If I come for a shell, shell moment of inertia is 2 by 3 mr square. Why the moment of inertia reduced? Because mass is distributed between, different distances. When I'm rotating the shell here, there's some mass near to the axis, some more mass nearer. So mass is distributed different parts. And here, if I have to find what is radius of gyration, I get a value of k equal to root 2 by 3 r. So I can place the entire mass, I can replace, in terms of calculation of moment of inertia, it is equivalent to entire mass of a shell placed at a distance of root 2 by 3 into r. So this is something like this I can visualize. This is where the entire mass is. This, it gives a kind of a visual understanding of how the mass is distributed in case of shell with reference to axis of rotation. Next, if I go to disk, you notice here, see why this K is decreasing in relatively more and more share of mass is closer to this axis of rotation. In case of disk is 1 by 2 mr square, it becomes even smaller and K value also becomes smaller. So this is right in indication of K value here, K being the distance from the axis. And the least of all is sphere. Sphere, you notice, because sphere is compared to shell. Shell has more mass farther away compared to shell. Sphere has greater proportion of mass nearer to center. And that's why moment of inertia is lesser. And that's why K value is lesser. So this is the order. K value is smallest for sphere. Sphere, disk, shell, ring. Sphere, shell, disk, ring. And this is very easy to understand also what is like this. So if all these objects are set into rolling, all are rolling. Ring is rolling, shell is rolling, disk is rolling, sphere is rolling. All of them have same mass and same radius. See, in this case, if all are rolling with the same mass and same velocity, translation kinetic energy of all will be same. But rotational kinetic energy will be highest in the ring, lesser in the shell, even lesser in the disk, least in the sphere. So this gives an idea. So farther the mass is, and you can understand also, if the mass is situated farther away, higher proportion of mass is moving at a higher speed. Because mass which is very close to the axis of rotation will have closer to zero speed. So more the mass situated away from axis of rotation, higher the value of K is, and higher is the proportion of rotational kinetic energy. And this is something we can kind of give a relative understanding. Ring, shell, disk, and sphere. Okay, let's try and understand here. How do we calculate kinetic energy? Let's say if this is something, see, pay attention, and this is something little uncommon kind of question. Just think of a thin hollow sphere. So you can imagine you have a metal ball and a thin hollow sphere, and it is completely filled with non-viscous liquid of mass. So I fill up the ball. The ball itself has a mass, or thin hollow sphere has mass m, and we fill up the liquid also, completely filled up of mass m. And I start rolling this ball. Okay, when I start rolling the ball, when the sphere rolls on the horizontal ground, such that the center. So if I look, I observe the sphere. See, basically, when you look at any spherical shaped object in motion, we don't observe the motion of different particles. We see as if the whole object has moved. When we see the whole object has moved, what exactly we are observing? We are observing the motion of the center of mass. So when center of mass moves with velocity vcm, what is the kinetic energy of the system? Let's understand kinetic energy system. System is composed of two parts here. A spherical shell, which is rolling, and the liquid which is filled inside. Okay. So just try and understand what difference non-viscous liquid makes. Just imagine, suppose you take an egg. Egg is perhaps a little oval shape, but you just think of it when an egg is not boiled. And when you spin the egg here, if filling inside the yolk part, if that was non-viscous, when you rotate the shell, the yolk will not rotate if it is non-viscous. But if it is viscous or if it is completely sticking to the wall, which happens when you boil it, it becomes part of the whole system. When you rotate the egg, entire mass rotates. So in this case, what will happen? Because of viscosity tends to make the liquid particle stick to the surface. So that particle also acquires same velocity at the surface velocity. But in this case, it is non-viscous. What will happen? This ball, when it is rolling, it will have angular velocity, it will have linear velocity. But all liquid inside, if I look at the liquid particle, they will not be rotating. There will be certain rotation. All liquid particle will only have translation. So if I have liquid particle here, I will see same liquid particle reaching here. But as it keeps rolling, different particles on the sphere will have rotation as well. So shell will have rolling, and liquid inside will have only translation. So this will have kinetic energy, which has translation plus rotation, and this will have only translation. So spherical shell, Vcm is equal to r omega, that's a condition. This is kinetic energy is equal to 1 by 2 mv square plus 1 by 2 I omega square. And in case of spherical shell, 2 by 3 mf square omega square, that's the kinetic energy of the shell. Same mass, moving velocity Vcm. But shell can only exert normal reaction on the liquid, which provides no torque, hence liquid, to set the liquid in rotation. It will only have translation, and his kinetic energy will be only translation kinetic energy, 1 by 2 mv square. So we are discussing more of energy, kinetic energy, work done, those things, and we come to other things later. Just imagine here, so this rod here, and a rod of length L, and force F acts perpendicular to the rod. Length of the rod is 1.5 meter, it is hinged at one end. How is the force applied? Acts perpendicular to rod. So it always remains perpendicular. So basically, when the rod has rotated some angle theta here, rod has moved like this along this path here. So again, the direction of force also still remains perpendicular. That's how the force is acting. We are applying the force always perpendicular to the rod. So what is work done by the torque as the rod rotates to angle of 30 degree? So what are we trying to do here now? We are trying to understand work done by torque. But here also, we can still, torque also has a force here. I can still calculate work done by force, and I can separately calculate what is work done by torque. So work done by force is equal to force into displacement here. Is this a constant force here? Though the magnitude of force is constant, its direction is changing. So it's not a constant force. But as it moves along this path here, so if I take any small element dl here, what is the work done by force? Force work done is F into dl, because force is always along the path here. So what is work done? Work done for a small element will be F into dl cos theta is equal to 1. So total work done will be equal to F into dl, which is, what is this dl? It's not a vector now. I have written the magnitudes, because there's cos theta is equal to 1 here. And if it, what is dl here? If it is not a vector sum, dl is nothing but path length. So what is work done here? Force into length of the arc of displacement. So that will be, arc length will be equal to theta into r. Theta is equal to pi by 6. So work done will be equal to F into pi by 6 into L. That's the work done by force. I have not used any concept of torque. But if I take these two things together, what is F into L? F into L is nothing but torque, and this is theta. So what is work done by a torque? Work done by a torque is equal to tau into delta theta. That's work done, and it runs parallel to linear motion, is equivalent of force and displacement. So I could have calculated torque also. I could have written torque like this, and we can calculate a work done like this. Okay. Let's some more question here. Let's say a rod AB of mass M and length L. This is basically, I'm spending more time on energy part. Energy part becomes useful in rolling also. Uniform rod AB, mass M, length L, is free to rotate about a hinge A. It is released from horizontal position. At the instance, it is passing through vertical position. When we release it from here, of course, it will start falling. It will have circular motion. It will have rotational motion in vertical plane. So at some instance of time, it becomes vertical. It will become vertical. And when it has become vertical, there's no translation here. And when it becomes vertical, it may have some angular velocity. We need to calculate what the angular velocity is. So here also I'm applying conservation of energy, but now I'm applying conservation of energy to not a translation motion, we're applying to rotational motion. How do we calculate, how do we apply conservation of mechanical energy in case of rotation? And this also is fairly simple. And what is happening here, if I take this object here, as it falls here, only force acting is gravity here and reaction force. But at this point, there's no displacement. The reaction force, which are non-conservative, are not doing any work. I can conserve mechanical energy. So what are the energy here? So, okay, gravitational potential energy and kinetic energy. Only difference here. So when we look at gravitational potential energy, I look at how the position of center mass has changed. So in case of gravitational potential energy, the center of mass, so if I look at earlier, it was at this position, has moved to this position. So if I take this as a reference level, and this is my initial state, and this is my final state, what is the change in gravitational potential energy? I could have written the initial energy and final energy. I'm just writing the loss of gravitational potential energy is equal to mg into L by 2. And where that energy is gone, it has gone in form of kinetic energy, but now this entire kinetic energy in form of rotational kinetic energy. So 1 by 2 I into omega square, which I do we take about axis about which it is rotating. It is rotating about endpoint here. So ML square by 3, I get the value of omega when it is passing through the lowest point. The rod will have angular velocity omega when it is moving, when it's at the rod is vertical. Okay, now second part here. How do we calculate hinge force when it is passing through the, when it is vertical, in the vertical state, when it has become vertical, when it's passing through vertical position, what is the hinge reaction? How would I calculate? So in this case also, one way of solving would be, it is not a particle. It's not like laws of motion. There, see, rod is composed of several particles. But I can rather, if I have to apply laws of motion, I can apply laws of motion to motion of center of mass. So I replace the whole rod with one particle placed at center of mass. So this whole rod is placed at, this is where the rod is, mass is M. And this particular point, what is the velocity this is having? And if I replace like this, this particle, center of mass, what is the nature of center of mass motion? Center of mass is undergoing circular motion of L by 2. So whole rod motion for purpose of analysis of laws of motion, that's whole objective of center of mass concept is, I have replaced with one particle and I'm tracing the motion of that particle, circular motion. So now properties of circular motion are applicable. It is having circular motion. At this instance, angular velocity is omega. Hence, net force acting on the center of mass, net external force acting on the center of mass has to be equal to M into R, which is L by 2 into omega square. Thus, a force, external force, must be acting on rod as a system, and which is we can apply those forces into on central mass. But let's see what are the forces acting on this mass here, on the rod. What are the external forces acting on the rod when it has become vertical? Only two forces acting, external forces. External forces acting are on the rod alone is gravity acting downwards and hinge reaction upwards. And since net acceleration is only in the vertical direction, no horizontal acceleration, so it will have hinge will not have any horizontal reaction. It will have only vertical reaction, because in this particular point. And so when we apply this condition of circular motion, summation of centripetal forces have to be equal to mr omega square. If I write this equation, what is the equation I write here? This is the centripetal direction. What are forces acting in the centripetal direction? Hinge reaction. Let me call hinge reaction as H acting in the centripetal direction. So though it is acting here, external force, I bring it and apply it here, H here. And what is acting is mg. So H minus mg is equal to summation of centripetal component has to be equal to m into radius of circular motion into omega square. You have found the value of omega square here. We substitute the value. We find H is equal to 4 mg. So that's a hinge reaction here. So that is additional point. And if we want to find out tension at the midpoint of the rod, again, we can extend the concept of circular motion. How do you extend the concept of circular motion? If I want to find when the rod has reached here, this will be lower part of the rod. I want to find out what is the tension acting at the midpoint of the rod. So again, this part now becomes half a rod here. Again, I'll consider motion of center of mass of this part of the rod alone. So how is center of mass here moving? The center of mass also is moving in a circular path of radius 3L by 4. Its radius is 3L by 4 and angular velocity is omega. Hence, here also I can apply centripetal forces, summation of this condition here. What are the forces acting on this rod here? External forces, tension, and its weight. Since now I'm taking half the rod, it will become, mass becomes m by 2 into g. I can calculate tension here. So this is optional. Some of you can calculate, and we can analyze tension acting at different parts of the rod also. Okay. Continuing with this rolling motion here, coming back to see, this is like a hoop. It's a circular ring. It is rolling on the ground without slipping. And if I look at the center, its axis. Axis is moving velocity v. So we want to find out there's a part, but there are different parts on the hoop. There's a point P which makes an angle theta here, as shown here. So can we find velocity of this point P? How do I find velocity of point P? There are two ways of finding velocity of point P. What is the first method of velocity of point P? Translation of hoop and rotation. So this hoop having pure translation velocity is V. So this point also will have a translation velocity of V here. It will have translation of V. And it is also having a rotation. And what is angular velocity omega? It is rolling without slipping. Omega has to be equal to V by R. And if it is V by R omega, any particle on the object will have, due to rotation, instantaneous velocity will be R into omega, which is again equal to V. Now, so these two, so what is velocity of point P? I can take the vector sum of these two. Thus, one way by breaking into two parts, velocity due to translation and velocity due to rotation. And with theta and all, you can, okay, it's not too difficult. This angle becomes theta, this 90. And so we can find the angle between the two and find the resultant using law of parallelogram. What is the second method? Let's look at the second method also. Second method, if it is rolling, this point is at the momentary rest. It is equivalent to whole ring having pure rotation about this axis with angular velocity omega, which is equal to V by R. Omega remains same. If this is V by R, this is axis of rotation, any point on the ring will have velocity only due to rotation. And the velocity will be R times omega, R being the distance. and which direction it will perpendicular to line PQ. So if I use the concept of this being axis of rotation, hoop is rotating about point of contact on the ground Q, it is rotating about point Q. Speed of point P will be equal to the distance PQ into omega. All I need to do, I will find distance PQ. What is distance PQ if I drop a perpendicular from here? This becomes theta by 2. This is R. So this becomes R sine theta by 2. So PQ is equal to 2R sine theta by 2. So I substitute value of P, 2R sine theta by 2. And omega is V by R. That's the speed of point P. You can calculate other method also. We can come to the same thing. Okay. Now come to this something here. Done some combination of translation rotation. And concept of translation rotation will also apply to object which is rolling on an inclined plane. Let's understand rolling on inclined plane. It could be any of those four shapes what we discussed. So condition for rolling, vector sum of the two is equal to zero. They have to be opposite. Yes, opposite has to come zero. So V, VCM plus R omega, this vector sum. Of course, the omega direction has to be opposite so that add up to zero. If it is rolling at all instances, this condition has to hold true at all points of time, at all times. At all times means if it takes its derivative also, it should hold good. If I take its derivative, it becomes ACM plus R alpha is equal to zero. So angular acceleration about central mass and linear acceleration of central mass has to have this relationship, and they must produce, they must act in the opposite sense. Let's see what it means here. Translation motion. So in this case also, what are we going to do here? So when this object is rolling, we'll apply using laws of motion, translation motion, and rotation motion. We'll identify all the forces which are acting. We'll take pure translation motion. Using translation motion, we'll calculate acceleration. And then we'll calculate pure rotation about central mass. So we'll calculate torque, moment of inertia. We'll calculate value of alpha. So we'll calculate A value, alpha value, and substitute in this condition. And that's the condition it has to meet here. So let's mark here what are the forces acting on the object. Forces acting on the object in this angle is theta. And for rotation motion, let's mark this is equal to mg sine theta. And this will be mg cos theta and normal reaction. These two will be equal and cancel out. And there will be friction force. These two forces will cancel out each other. So when we calculate, how do we analyze motion of central mass? I can replace the whole object by a point mass and all external forces applied at this point here. So which are the forces acting along the slope here? Mg sine theta is acting down the slope, and I am assuming friction is opposite here. We can make assumption and check whether assumption was correct or not later here. And actually, yes, it will act in the upward direction. So if I apply laws of motion and calculate acceleration, acceleration is equal to net force minus ma, by m. So mg sine theta minus f by m is ACM. Similarly, rotation about central mass. So if this is central mass, what is the torque acting about this? You have to calculate alpha here. So this force has zero torque. This has zero torque. This has zero torque. Torque is only because of friction about central mass. And friction is acting in the tangential direction. Hence, perpendicular distance is equal to r. In which sense it is acting in this sense here? That's the sense of torque here. And alpha also will be produced in the same sense. So what is torque about central mass? F into R. Divide by I. I is equal to M into K square. K value will depend on whether it's sphere, hollow sphere, or whatever. I am dividing. We are arriving at a general formula which is valid for all shapes. So when I substitute here, when I substitute in this equation, ACM becomes R alpha because R alpha direction is opposite. So when I substitute and multiply this with R, and equate to A, I get value of F here. F value comes equal to mg sine theta divided by 1 plus R square by K square. Frick. And so that's the condition. R comes in the numerator, K comes in the denominator. That's value of friction force. And you notice here, friction force is less than mg sine theta because this value in the denominator is greater than 1. And that's why it has downward acceleration. If friction force was equal to mg sine theta, it wouldn't have had a downward acceleration. And this friction force has to be less than maximum friction force possible to ensure pure rolling. So this is a condition, and whenever say the friction is rough enough to ensure pure rolling, it implies maximum friction force possible is less than friction force which is required to ensure rolling. This is kind of force, friction force required to ensure pure rolling. And of course, it will depend on theta. It depends on the shape also. And if I have this value of F, I substitute here, I get the value of acceleration. And acceleration, of course, has to be less than g sine theta. Because if friction was not there, you would have acceleration of g sine theta. Now, friction is acting, that's why the acceleration is lower. So what is acceleration? G sine theta by a number greater than 1. What is number? It is inverse of this. It is 1 plus r square by k square. It is 1 plus k square by r square. So let's understand what is the order of acceleration. So acceleration for different shape. This k value depends on the shape. And we, if you recall, what is the order of k? Order of k highest for the ring. And then it was for what? Then it was for the shell. Then it was for the disk. And least was for, k value was for solid sphere. So what happens as the k, order of acceleration? So which one will have highest acceleration? The one which has smallest denominator will have highest acceleration. So which will have highest denominator? Which will have highest acceleration, which will have smallest denominator, and the one with the smallest denominator will have to have smallest k value. And k is smallest for which shape here? K is smallest for a sphere. That's why when I keep all four objects together on inclined plane, which will have highest acceleration? Sphere will have highest acceleration, and sphere will have, ring will have least acceleration. So when they reach the bottom, who will win the race? Sphere will win the race, and ring will come last. That we can understand from this equation itself. Order of acceleration, lowest k will have highest acceleration, and we can substitute. Yes?
Sir, in the why is friction less than nu into normal reaction here? Sir, isn't it supposed to be equal because it's kinetic friction?
Is there slipping taking place? See, kinetic friction.
So because the point is at rest, it's static.
Yes, friction. There's no relative motion. That's a condition for rolling. Okay, so it is not kinetic friction. Okay, now let's look at this last sub question.
Sir, if ACM is equal to R alpha, that will mean the point in contact with the incline is that it doesn't have velocity and acceleration, right?
It has, at that point, it will have zero tangential acceleration. I'm equating acceleration only in the tangential direction along the surface. It can have normal acceleration, which it will have. Which direction we're equating? We're equating only the surface direction. For no slipping, this is a condition. Yes, this point will have zero tangential acceleration. That statement is not correct. It will have acceleration. Yes, it will have acceleration in the normal direction. Okay, let's look at this. And this figure is not great, but I could get a better figure. Let's see if the surface is something like this. Rather than like this, surface is something like this. So the surface, and we have a solid sphere is rolling on a rough surface. It's a rough surface, and surface goes like this. And it has a particular instance, it is rolling with the speed V. We can see the ball rolling. And when it's rolling, it is also different particles are undergoing rotation as well. And we can think of, that's what you're thinking, where we can break this motion into two parts, pure translation plus rotation about central mass. So if a solid sphere is rolling on a rough surface and velocity is V here, this sphere climbs up a height h. So on inclined plane, and it climbs up, it reaches a maximum height h here. So basically, when we talk height h here, it reaches a point h here. And in this case, see, though radius is assumed to be small. So basically from here, this radius also, radius is assumed to be much, much less than h. Why it is important here? So the question is, what is the maximum height it will rise? See, so far we have seen if object was sliding on a surface, it will rise to maximum height of V square by 2G. And we used to arrive at that condition based on conservation of energy. Here also we'll apply conservation of energy here, but there is a slight difference here. See, if the surface was, if I change this question slightly, if I make the question something like this, it's an inclined plane. And if it is rolling on an inclined plane, which has constant angle here. In this case, what is the maximum height it can travel? I could have calculated using kinematics also. If theta was constant, I could have calculated acceleration, which will act in the downward direction. So I know how much distance it will travel. I can calculate height also accordingly. But here the slope is changing, so I can't use kinematics here. And so I have to use conservation of energy. So when it reaches highest point, of course, when it reaches the highest point here, the velocity becomes zero. That's the highest point here. And when the velocity becomes omega also becomes zero, if it is rough surface. Rough surface means always V is equal to R omega and friction is acting. So I'll equate the energy here. The total energy here has to be equal to total energy here. Here the total energy in form of kinetic energy. What is the reference level taken? I'm taking the reference level as center of mass of the sphere. So is kinetic energy 1 by 2 mv square due to translation? 1 by 2 mk square is moment of inertia. And every time I'm using k term here so that it is valid for all shapes into v square by r square is equal to mgh. See, in this case, actually, h, when we calculate delta h here, delta h could have been equal to h minus r here. Okay. If r is the height of the surface, unless h is given from center to center. When the figure is correctly drawn from this center, height of when it reaches highest point, if that is h, then this is potential energy, mgh. And we equate here and we can easily find h here. What I notice from value of h here, the maximum height it will reach will depend on if v is constant. Only one term can change depending on shape of the object. If I replace sphere, if I have a sphere here, what is the value of k? I'll substitute here. Mk square is equal to 2 by 5 mr square, if it is sphere. And if it is a hollow sphere, it becomes 2 by 3 mr square. The k value has different terms here. So as we have different shapes here, the total energy is changing. If the total energy is changing, h also will be different. So if we have all four shapes here, we have sphere, we have ring, and then we have shell, and we have a cylinder, and we have solid sphere. If all of them set into rolling, same velocity v, which will reach the highest point here? Which will reach the greater height?
Right.
And the one which has highest moment of inertia will reach the maximum height. Which will have highest moment of inertia? Ring will have the highest moment of inertia. And so it will reach, so you notice here, for each shape, I can have different value of mk square. Hence, the height will differ. And we should be easily able to apply conservation of mechanical energy and calculate the height reached. So this also is an important question, which all of us should be able to solve. Understand? If you understand, rest all is okay. Okay. What happens if the surface is smooth? In this case, if the surface is smooth, will it reach the same height or will the height change?
Different height.
Why height will be different?
Won't stop rotating.
Yes. So in this case, when the surface is rough, maximum height corresponds to state when velocity becomes zero. Because velocity becomes zero, then only stop going further up. Okay. And if surface is rough, V and omega are always related. Because friction force always ensures as the V changes, friction force is changing omega also. That's what friction does. So V and omega, so V becomes zero, V is equal to R omega is always maintained. This becomes zero implies omega also has become zero. So rotational energy also becomes zero, kinetic energy also becomes zero. Rotational kinetic energy becomes zero, translational kinetic energy also becomes zero. But if there's no friction, then this term will not change. Omega will remain the same. So if we start with this rolling here, when it's this surface smooth here, when it reaches the top, V will be zero, but omega will be same which was there at the bottom, same omega value. So gain in potential energy will be only on account of loss of translation kinetic energy. So if I write the equation, there's no friction on the right hand side. Again, I would have added the rotational kinetic energy will remain unchanged. Because omega will not change. For change of omega, friction is necessary. That's why H will become less. Okay, now some more application on the thing. A ball of radius r rolls inside a fixed hemispherical shell. We have fixed hemispherical shell of radius r. So this is radius r here. and there is a small spherical ball of it is small r here. It rolls inside, released from point A. And what is the normal reaction when it passes through B, bottommost point? So first of all, when it passes through bottommost point here, and what is given here, it rolls. So it rolls means when it reaches here at the bottom, it will have certain velocity as well. And it will also have omega, and V is equal to R omega. That relationship will apply. That's what rolling means. So when it reaches bottom here, very similar to previous question, can we calculate value of V here when it reaches the bottom? It's the reverse of the previous question. The previous question, this kinetic energy was getting lost, potential energy was being gained. Now potential energy getting lost, kinetic energy is gained. And since rolling is there, kinetic energy gain has both the forms, translation kinetic energy and rotational kinetic energy in a fixed proportion. So what happened when it reaches bottom? Will it reach with this? See, if friction was not there, entire energy would have been in form of translation kinetic energy. V would have been higher. Now, since the same potential energy is shared between two parts, translation plus rotation, it will reach the bottom with a lower speed compared to an object which just slides down without rolling. Okay. So again, in this case also, if I apply conservation of mechanical energy, I take for gravitational, I take the reference level. If I take the reference level, what is the final energy here? I'm writing the final energy first, then the initial energy. Final energy is equal to potential energy zero because I have taken that this as a reference. 1 by 2 mv square, translation kinetic energy plus rotational kinetic energy. Since it is rolling, that's why omega is V by R, is equal to potential energy here and potential energy here. See, from here the height is R. From the since I have taken reference point at the center mass, height is R minus a small r. But if R is much smaller than capital R, this can always be written as mgr. That's what the question is. So from this, is it possible to calculate V? I can easily calculate value of V. And since it is sphere, I can calculate the hemispherical shell. With a hemispherical shell here, this term will be equal to how much? Mk square. This is nothing but moment of inertia. For hemispherical shell, what is the moment of inertia? What I have written, so, this is ball. So this is sphere. So rolling object is a sphere, 2 by 5 mr square. And this I will substitute here. And I can find value of V. Why do I need V here? Once I need V, the small r, we can calculate here. This we get, we can calculate V square. To find normal reaction, I have to apply laws of motion to an object which is not a point object. So again, I can apply to motion of center of mass. So what is the kind of motion center of mass is having? Center of mass is having a circular motion of radius capital R minus small r. But if small r is small, I can take it is having a circular motion of radius r. And if it is having circular motion of radius r, it will have at this point, it will have this centripetal direction. Summation of forces in the centripetal direction has to be equal to m into v square by radius of circular motion. So what are the values I'll substitute? What are the forces acting towards center? Normal reaction minus mg is equal to m by r into v square. How do I get v square? V square term I get from here and substitute. You can form the normal reaction for any shape. In any shape, it could be a ring, it could be a sphere, it could be a spherical shell, it could be a disc. All cases, we can find the normal reactions. Okay. So I'll just stop here. Almost time. And